Next topic is exceptions to consideration. And exceptions to consideration are inequity, and we learned about promissory estoppel and promissory restitution. These are alternatives to consideration. And when we think about equity, I'd like you to think about Colonel Thomas Wolsey, who established the Court of Chancery, who effectively established the equitable courts in England. And so, unsurprisingly, given this was a creation of the church, these equitable remedies look at moral conduct, good character, other factors that might relate to whether justice requires a remedy beyond what the law will provide. And those two alternatives we looked at for remedy are promissory estoppel and promissory restitution. Promissory estoppel requires a promise, and that promise is something that the promisor would expect to induce reliance. There was, in fact, reliance subsequent to the promise. And injustice can be avoided only by that enforcement. And so we have our sort of timeline here. We have first a promise, followed by an action in forbearance or an action in reliance of that promise, and then justice requires its enforcement. So we had a couple cases that pertain to this, Kirksey versus Kirksey, which was about promissory estoppel. We have the letter to my dear Antilico, basically saying, come settle on the land, right? So that's a promise. If you come, I will give you this land to settle upon. We have the widow actually come and settle on the land, so we in fact have we actually have that action which was foreseeable. You get a letter saying come settle on the land, you follow it, okay, so we have that action. And here where we have a widow who would otherwise be destitute, we have the element of justice met as well. And then we had similarly in the case of Ricketts v. Scotthorn, no consideration because Grandpa Ricketts promised to give Katie a gift, if you'll remember, to put her in a position of independence. He hoped she'd give up her job, but didn't ask for it, so it wasn't consideration. But she did actually give up her job, and she sued the estate. But this came out a bit differently because it turned out that justice didn't require an enforcement of this promise. She had gotten some of the payments, and she was able to get back to work, and so justice didn't require enforcement there. Near and dear to your hearts would be Conrad v. Fields. This was the case where a potential law student was induced to attend law school because a neighbor who is wealthy and philanthropic promised to pay that law school education. And so are the elements met here? Fields promised to pay for law school, and as a result of that, induced by that, she goes ahead and takes on the debt. The court here finds that justice requires enforcement of that promise. In Hayes v. Plantation Steel Company, we again have those factors. Hayes announces his retirement. Plantation promises to pay subsequent to the announcement. And now does justice require? Well, the problem with this case is we've inverted the order. It cannot be that the promise to pay the pension induced the retirement because the retirement was announced and decided before the promise was made. And so this is a better case for a Section 86 promissory restitution, but promissory estoppel would not be available here. We also have a special rule under the restatement pertaining to charitable subscriptions. A charitable subscription is binding without proof of inducement, with actually induced action or actually induced forbearance. We saw the flip side in Maryland National Bank, a case that was right at the gap between the first and second restatement. And so Maryland Bank versus United Jewish Appeal tried to find inducement by United Jewish Appeal, did not find it, and so did not grant the remedy. But under the restatement, under common law today, we would not have that requirement. And so, again, what did that look like? We have a promise, right? And then that promise, it was a promise to provide money. The individual who made that promise was then used as an example for others. It's not clear that that constituted inducement or reliance. It's not clear that justice required enforcement of that promise. However, this case would come out differently today because that requirement of inducement, actual inducement or forbearance, is not required today. And our last case for that lesson is Pavel Enterprises. It was a somewhat long or technical case, but it went through the four-factor test. And what was nice about Pavel is it brought the idea of reasonable reliance and reasonable inducement, whether the promisee was reasonable in forbearing or acting. And so that was a bit of a different version of the test that we see in the restatement, but it's a reminder that that reasonableness comes into at least the justice element, and justice is not going to require enforcement of a promise where reliance on it was not reasonable. And here we see the test phrased a little differently, but it comes out the same way. Our second doctrine then is promissory restitution, a promise made in recognition of a benefit previously received. So we have an action and then a promise. And then are we going to find that binding to prevent injustice? So we flip to the purple arrow, right? And we see that the benefit now comes before the promise. And so the promise, is it going to act retroactively? We have then identified five categories of contracts where we are going to generally enforce this contract. Promises to correct a mistake, to pay for emergency services, to reimburse a gift, to pay for someone else's contract, to pay for a debt. Mills versus Wyman is the standard case. In Mills versus Wyman, a young man gets sick at sea. He is taken care of by a family. That's an action. His father then later promises to pay. But there's nothing else additional here. The son is not the father. They're not, you know, this person did not directly receive a benefit for what he promised for. And so the court does not require enforcement of this promise. Justice does not require enforcement of the promise. And so Mills versus Wyman sets the standard rule. Drake v. Bell is the case where we have a promise to correct a mistake. A person fixes the wrong house, and that was a mistake. Another person comes in, promises to pay for the repairs. And here we find that was enforced. Booth v. Fitzpatrick. Promise to pay for necessaries. This is the case where a bull wandered onto someone else's land, and that person cared for it. B then promised subsequently to pay for it. We actually see when we read the case that there was quite a lot of additional factors there as well, but effectively we have the provision of necessaries, the care for the bull, and so we get into our exception there. Webb v. McGowan is a promise to pay for emergency services, and here we have an individual save another person's life. Obviously, you can't make a promise, right? This was in the mill, chucking a huge log was going to hit someone on the head. The person diverted it, got badly injured in the process. Later, that person whose life was saved promised to pay a pension for the remainder of the savior's life. Is that going to be enforceable? Well, this was a provision of emergency services. We have a promise. We have the other elements met, and we are going to enforce that promise as well. Haynes Chemical had the concept of promising to pay for a gift. And so in this case, there wasn't really a gift given. We had a consulting company, and the consulting company gave a free consult. But the idea was to eventually get business. They did not get the business for reasons that seemed to do more with the preference for New York versus Virginia versus the quality of the firm. The firm that did not give the business made a promise to compensate them for the amount that they would have gotten for the consult. And here, since this wasn't really a gift and there was a promise subsequently to pay, we will enforce it. Then in Edson v. Pop, we have a well that is dug on the land of B because of tenant C's request. Tenant C does not pay for the well, but B receives a benefit for this contract. And so Edson, and so the landlord agrees to pay for the well for someone else's contract where the benefit was actually received, and so then we get into that category as well. And since that promise was based on another contract, and because the landlord actually received the long-term benefit, that will be enforceable as well. Now, keeping in mind, of course, that these equitable remedies are unusual, those are five cases where they will typically be enforced, and that brings us through our discussion of equity.